tributes to her. And the first tribute will come from her beloved son, Mitchell. So Mitchell, if you'll unmute yourself, and I suggest that for the next part, folks, that we go to the upper right, and instead of have galaxy view, put it, click on speaker view so we can see Mitchell and feel his presence. Mitchell, are you there?
Yes, Fred, I'll go ahead. Just waiting for the okay. So everybody, you hear me fine? Okay. I first wanted to say thank you all for being here on behalf of my brothers and their families, as well as all of us who loved her so much. I'm really, really appreciative that you're all here today. And like Fred said, we've got people in California as well, in New York and all places in between. As the Wicked Witch would often say, what a world, what a world. We never dreamed that we'd be living at a time when we are having bar mitzvahs and weddings and all kinds of simchas and celebrations virtually, including my mom's funeral and ceremony. I set up a little altar. I don't know if you could really see it behind me. I'm gonna move a little bit to the side there, but it makes me feel good. I got some beautiful flowers from some of you. And so I set up all these flowers. I have the yard side candle and a picture of mom in San Francisco. And I'm walking around the house talking to her, because for the last 2.5 years as her caregiver, every day, hey, ma, hey, ma, hey, ma. And so I got so used to saying, hey, ma, that I'm walking around the house like a bissel famished. There's going to be some Yiddish during this, so get used to it. Those of you who know me, there's always a Yiddish lesson when we're together. Walking around like I'm a little bit mixed up, but I'm calling out for my mother, and I'm looking for her. I wanted to, before I forget, thank my daughter Devin for putting together that beautiful video. It's something our family will cherish. And Fred, just a reminder, right, you're recording this for us, right, Fred? Thank you. Okay, so how am I? It depends on the moment, right? Sometimes I'm walking around the altars, and Blair sent me a box of Katz's Deli from New York. I'm eating a hot dog with a knish, and I'm the happiest boy in the world. And then I'll suddenly see a picture of mom on the wall, and I'll just absolutely lose it. The last days with mom were very, very special. Those last weeks coming into her room, they allowed me in once they knew that she was near end of life. And I can't tell you how great it was to reunite after COVID, separating us for so many months, and being able to brush her hair and hold her hand and sing her show tunes, feed her grapes, and just be close to her so she understood she was not alone as things were getting closer and closer. But even through that, my mother always had a sense of humor. She could barely talk. She could barely communicate. I must have done every show tune that there is in the history of Broadway. And I remember just a few weeks ago, I sang to her one of her favorite songs, Some Enchanted Evening from South Pacific. And it was over. I said, Ma, how was it? And she got it together and she said, nice, nice. And then I got up and I performed New York, New York. I did the whole thing with the razzle and the dazzle. I said, Ma, how was it? And she says, a little loud. I said, okay, all right, Ma. So she had her opinion. I do want you all to know, because you were all very, very concerned what happened at the end, because, you know, we were all separated because of this fakakta pandemic. But I want you to know that in the end, COVID ravaged mom's wing where she was staying. In the end, 15 people, residents, were positive, and 7 staff people. And after me being with mom for day after day, they called me to tell me mom got it. And so you can imagine what it meant to go in there every day to make sure that she was not alone and to hold her hand and be with her. But in the end, that horrible thing got her, and she was so frail that as soon as she got COVID, she moved into a coma. But I want you all to know she was so peaceful. I used to call her Sleeping Beauty when I came in to see her. She looked just like Sleeping Beauty, just very peaceful and restful, laying there, not eating and not drinking, and slowly, slowly going into a deeper sleep, but never in pain, never uncomfortable, never unhappy. She seemed very, very calm, and I was very grateful for that. It's been difficult, I won't say not. Normally, I'd have the blessings of all of you around me and hugs and kisses, but this is the world we're living in. So again, I want to tell you how much it means that you're here today. So 2020, when I was growing up, 2020 meant clear vision, seeing everything perfectly, seeing everything clearly. And in some strange way, it seems appropriate that Mom died in 2020 because Mom really did see things clearly. Mom had really good vision. She came into the world February 11, 1928. She came in 8 years after the Spanish flu pandemic and 1 year before the Great Depression. And she went out with the worst depression that she had ever experienced in her lifetime and a COVID pandemic, sort of going full circle in a strange kind of a way. But in those 92 years, Mom really, really lived. She lived simply. She wasn't a grand lady of all kinds of fancy schmancy things. She lived simply, but she really lived. Mom's story started out kind of typical in that she grew up in the Bronx. She was the daughter of Polish immigrants. She grew up, born in Brooklyn, they moved to the Bronx, grew up on the hillside. She was the children of David and Hannah Bank. When she was a young girl, because everybody spoke Yiddish in her world, my grandparents sent her to the Sholem Aleichem school in her neighborhood, and she learned how to speak Yiddish. And Mom was fluent in Yiddish her whole life. I also remember at Temple, whenever she and Hank Brott would run into each other, I used to enjoy watching the two of them chepper each other, going at it in Yiddish. It was really something wonderful to see. She went to a Vanderchild High School in the Bronx, and then the war broke out. My grandfather was a plumber by trade. He could not find any work, and a job opened up in Beaumont, Texas, of all places. So they packed up the car, and they moved to Beaumont, Texas, and that's where my mom and my uncle went to school. Mom went to high school at Beaumont High School, and that's where she graduated. And then when the war was over, they came back to New York. Mom was very bright. And so she graduated high school at 16, wanted to become a nurse, and nursing school wanted her, but she was too young. She was gonna have to wait another year, and so she went to work, and then everything took a different turn. She met our father, Milty, when she was 17 years old. My father was a charmer. He was tall, he was good looking, he dressed nicely, he loved music, he loved show business, he loved to take her to shows and restaurants. And Mom, being 17 years old, she just got swept away by all of that. Because my grandparents were hardworking people. They didn't go to shows and restaurants and that kind of stuff. So she had a nice Jewish wedding. They went ahead and had three children. They lived in the Bronx. My father was in haberdashery. My mother was a homemaker. When things got a little bit better, we moved to Bronx Park East and had an apartment on the fourth floor with an elevator. And when you got an apartment with an elevator, you were really something. The elevator was the size of, you know, it was like a little box, but we had an elevator. So it seemed like a very lovely, typical Jewish family living in a nice Jewish neighborhood. And then everything changed. My father did not like to bring the wages home. He liked to spend it on records and photo albums and candy for himself. He did not really care too much for our children. He was busy doing other things. They did not get along. There were a lot of fights going on in the house, some that were really, really horrible as a child to experience. He left, he came back, he left, he came back, he left, he came back. And he finally left when I was about 10 or 11 years old. And Mom suddenly became the superwoman. She was a nonconformist. She had three boys. No women at that time worked. There wasn't a single woman in our neighborhood who worked. Every woman was in an apron, making matzo ball soup and waiting for her husband to come home. But Mom rolled up her sleeves and she went out and interviewed. And that time they weren't hiring women. And so she started out with some menial part-time job. Then she got a full-time job. First she was assistant bookkeeper. Then she was a bookkeeper. Then she was an assistant office manager. Then she became an office manager. And slowly, slowly things got better. No women drove anywhere. If you wanted a ride, your husband took you. But she had to go to work and she had three boys. So she went and she got herself a car. And her day was like any woman, except there was no husband to support her. Breakfast, pack the lunches, off to school, off to work, shop after work, schlep the bundles up in the elevator, make dinner for the kids, help them with their homework, make sure they all got showered, get them to bed, pass out, repeat. And that's what you do, and that's what Mom did. Mom fell in love with a Christian man when it was absolutely unheard of. In her generation, no Jewish woman would think of getting involved with a Jewish or a Christian man. But this is what happened. She met Mike. He was an Irish Catholic. They fell in love in the early years. The romance was a secret. She was very afraid for the family to find out. And I remember when my grandparents found out, they were horrified. I remember for a whole year, for Shabbos dinners, we used to have it every Friday night at my grandma, like clockwork. And for a whole year, my mom didn't come. And to my Uncle Leon's credit, after a year, we all sat down. We had a powwow at the kitchen table, and they worked it through. And they grew to love Mike, my grandparents. And Mom and Mike stayed married to close to 40 years, and they had a great life together. They traveled. They invested in real estate. They moved to Carlsbad, California in 1989 and bought a beautiful condo. And they had a great life out there. And even after Mike passed away about a decade ago, I was so impressed with my mother. Unlike a lot of women who would need to have another man or would need to move near the children and would be petrified of being on her own, Mom lived her life. She played Mahjong with her girlfriends. She joined the Altruista Club and volunteered. She had friends in the neighborhood association, and she lived an incredible life. I couldn't even understand. She lived two flights in a condo. I say, Ma, she was like already in her late 80s. Like, Ma, how do you climb up and down two flights of stairs every day? And she had a system. She threw her dirty clothes over the side because the washing machine was downstairs, and one step at a time, she'd come down for the day, and then at the end of the day, she'd slowly move her clean clothes up the stairs and climb up and make a life. And I also want to give a shout out right now to all of her girlfriends in California and her boyfriends. You were magnificent, giving Mom a great life in California, and especially after Mike died. On behalf of myself and Michael and Ira, how much it meant to us to know that Mom had such an incredible support system when she was out in California living on her own. She bought a house on Oak Island to come to the East Coast to be closer to the family. She was getting close to 90. Can you imagine a woman at 90 who buys a new home and sets up a new place and makes new friends? And she became the Mahjong queen of Oak Island. All the women, Christian and Jewish, all wanted to sit with Mom and learn how to play Mahjong. All of my Mahjong girls in Greensboro, my mom could kick your tuchus. She was the queen. She won contests. She won plaques. She won awards. She was the Mahjong queen. Until she got C. diff, and then everything changed. My friends, if you ever have a loved one that has to go to a rehab center or someplace like that, be very careful, because Mom caught C. diff, and that was the beginning of the end. Her life was her family. She loved her grandchildren. She loved her great-grandchildren. But she did have a special place for her three boys, because we went through the whole thing together. We had hard times, but Mom was amazing. We did it with humor. Mom would go to work, and then she would meet Mike secretly after work, and she wouldn't get home till 6, 7 o'clock. And when we would hear her coming up the elevator, we were terrible. We would get out a skull, some bones, We would get out a can of tuna fish, and the three of us would lay on the floor and we'd be reaching for that can of tuna fish, and we almost got it, but we died of starvation because she didn't come to make us a dinner. And she didn't always find that so funny when she would come in. And I also remember every other Monday, she would load us in the car and she took us to White Castle Hamburgers. And all of you know, if you don't like White Castle Hamburgers, you cannot be my friend. And so she threw the three boys in the back. In those days, the girls would come up to your window with the blue outfit. They put the tray on your window. She would order like 1,000 White Castles. They were like 10 cents a piece. And like animals, she would throw the whole bag in the back, and the three boys would just devour this bag of White Castles. And she would only have a black coffee. She would not eat one of those focaccia hamburgers, but she would get us thousands of them. And we had such great memories about that. Our kitchen was a hub for all our friends in the neighborhood. Mom was an incredible cook. And so all our friends would come over to the house and they would kind of hang out at the house around dinner time. And they would smell all the stuff coming out of the kitchen. And so they would say, like, what's your mom making for dinner? And I would say, chicken parmesan with spaghetti with garlic bread and salad. I guess I should go home. And then my mother would say, Michael, Hal, Lowell, whoever, what are you boys doing for dinner? Nothing, Ms. Gloria. Would you like to stay? Yes. And so we'd all pile into the kitchen and we would have these incredible meals. Mom had very close relationships with all three of her sons. Anybody who knows Michael and I will know we're all very different. But she had very close relationships with all three of us. Michael told me something the other day that I didn't know. In the last years, he called her every single day. They spoke on the phone and they would talk about everything. He would talk to her about his poop, making the cocky. And she'd want to know, was it an A plus or was it an A minus today? And he would say, no, Ma, today was a B plus. So she said, go back in. You can't come out until it's an A plus or an A minus. This is the conversations they had, Or he would sit her down and he would talk to her about needing her advice on his sons. And she would always say, he told me, can I tell you how I feel about it, in my opinion? And she would give her opinion. And Michael said almost all the time, Mom was right. Soccer, my brother Ira, he had a very difficult time when he was a young man. He almost died. We almost lost him. And Mom had to give him a lot of tough love. It was hard. When as a mother, you just want to feed them and give them money and do whatever they want. Mom had to really draw the line. In the end, he'll tell you this day, Mom saved his life. And she would say to him, I'm not telling you what to do, but if I were you, and he told me she was usually right. And for me, I always remember, I would come to her and I would be upset with somebody. Ma, I can't believe they did this, or Ma, I can't believe they didn't do that. And she would say, you got to see it from their side. Here's another way to look at things. And Mom was right. She had jet wavy black hair. She had sparkling blue-green eyes, just like my grandfather. We boys thought she looked just like Elizabeth Taylor. She was petite. But as we say in Yiddish, she was zaftik. She had meat on her bones. But it didn't seem to bother my father or my stepfather. She was a sexy woman being zaftik, and she was proud of who she was. She had a great laugh and smile. She was very welcoming. She was the Mahjong queen. She was the queen. She was the Costco queen. She loved to call me and tell me, oh my God, I went to Costco today. Look at these dishes. Look at this pot. I noshed this. I ate this. Look at this. She loved going to Costco. She was warm, generous, bright, insightful, strong, and stubborn. She never drank, she never smoked, she never did drugs, which is probably why she lived such a long time. She was a yenta. She was a modern yenta, but she was a yenta. If you were not with her, she never meddled in our lives. She never, ever meddled in anything we're doing. But if you stayed with her, or she was staying with you, Where are you going? What are you doing? Who called you? Who was it? What did they say? What did you say? What did they want? Where are you going? When are you going to be back? What are you eating? How much? That was Mom. She loved children. She loved little boys. And she loved to see Tunatana. So finally, I just wanted to share with you a couple of quick lessons I learned from my mother. You don't have to accept your circumstances if you are not happy in it. A lot of women in those days would have stayed with a man till the dying day miserable. No, she went out and she lived her life. When I, in the third grade, was told I had no talent, I did not belong in any kind of music or theater program at all. There's no way. My mother dragged me by the hand. We went into the principal's office. She gave him hell. She asked him to give me a chance in the music class. He said they would put me on a trial run. They put me in the music class, and I got the lead in the show. If my mother had not been my cheerleader and supported me, I never would have had a life of music and theater. Love is food and food is love. Chicken and veal parmesan, baked ziti, London broil, lox eggs and onions, roast stuffed chicken with stuffing, latkes, challah French toast, meatloaf with hard-boiled egg in it, tuna and egg with mayonnaise, and always with a compliment. She would fish for a compliment. I thought it was pretty good. Did you think it was good? Yes, Ma, it was wonderful. I thought it came out pretty. Yes, Ma, it was absolutely delicious. And so Thanksgiving, every Thanksgiving, oh, Ma, the turkey is just out of this world. And we used to get such a kick out of that. My mother never missed an extracurricular activity, whether Michael was playing the bass in the orchestra, Ira was playing Little League, or I was in a show. She was always there, always, always there. I never remember a show without Mom being in the audience. She was not an affectionate woman. Those who know me know I'm a big hugger, kisser, toucher, hold hand. My mother wasn't like that. I don't remember a lot of kisses and holding hands and hugs. I don't. But boy, did we know we were loved, right? She didn't have to say it. She didn't have to lay all over you. She gave you her life. She couldn't do enough for you. And so we knew from top to bottom that we were absolutely loved. She never judged anybody by your color, your religion, your sexuality, your economic status. I remember when I was very young, we had a lady, Annie Marshall, who was black, who came to help us every couple of weeks for a couple of dollars and some food to clean the house. And her daughter died of a drug overdose. And in those days, no white person went into Harlem. And I remember I was a little boy and my mother said, we have to go to her funeral. And so Mom and I went in the car down to Harlem, and we were the only white people in that church. And I remember how much it meant to Annie that my mother and I went to that funeral. And that's the way Mom was. She didn't have to ever sit me and my brothers down with a lecture about accepting people. She just did. She just embraced everybody. And so we modeled ourselves after her. I remember when I didn't make high school music and art, I was so crushed, I was so devastated. And she said to me, which is a great lesson, go be a big fish in a little pond. And it really served me well in high school. And not that I'm calling Greensboro a little pond, but it was where I found my way. And it was where I found a wonderful life. Maybe in New York, I would have gotten lost in the shuffle. But here, I found an opportunity to share what God-given gifts I was given. And love above all. Love above all. I'm not patting myself on the back, but I'm telling you this because I learned this from my mother. When she was dying and she was alone in that place, and they told me I could continue seeing her, and I knew she had COVID, and I knew everybody in there had COVID. And I didn't even think about it. Of course I had to go in there. Of course I had to hold her hand. Of course I had to brush her hair and tell her how much I loved her in her coma. Of course I did. Because that's the way Mom loved. Mom loved you fully. And that's how I loved her back. She was my first Valentine. She was my cheerleader, my mentor, my companion, my travel buddy. I loved seeing her face in the congregation. And so I say to you in closing, my friends, when I was 7 years old, she sent me to a Jewish school, the Bronx House, and they had a contest that you had to draw a picture of what your house was like during the Seder for Pesach. And I drew a picture of her beautiful table with the door open for Elijah and the cup of wine, and I drew everything. And I'll never forget that day at the assembly. They announced the third place winner and the second place winner, and the first place winner was Mitchell Summers. And I flew up on the stage and they gave me a Seder plate. And I remember I didn't walk, I flew home because I couldn't wait to give that to my mother, to show my mother how much I loved her, and that of everybody in the world, she was the one that I wanted to share that Seder plate. So as I go forward with the rest of my life, as I know my brothers and their partners and her grandchildren and her great-grandchildren, all of you, we go out and we live in honor with her. We live life fully. We love fully. And I will miss her very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Mitchell. Joan, if you can...
Joanne,
sorry, if you can unmute yourself.
I did. I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes, go ahead.
Okay, well, bear with me. I'm not a public speaker. I'd like to read something very personal and very short, and a short poem that I find appropriate. Gloria and I were more than mother-in-law and daughter-in-law. We were confidants, but mostly we were best friends. Even her boys used to tease that I was at the top notch, and they had to work hard to try to pass me. Even though we saw each other rarely over the past 22 years, we still reached out to each other from time to time. And our bond couldn't be broken. Even when she didn't remember me, we shared a laugh. Gloria represented many things to me: acceptance, outspokenness, kindness, stubbornness, generosity, feistiness, a strong, vibrant woman, and love. She was my true role model and helped me evolve into a strong woman. I have and will continue to treasure all our memories. Though Gloria, for me, you will never be gone, because I hold you close in my mind, heart, and spirit. Always loved and never forgotten.
Madison?
Oh, wait, can I just read this poem?
Go ahead.
I'm sorry, I was looking for it. Don't grieve for me, for now I'm free. I'm following the path God laid for me. I took his hand when I heard him call. I turned my back and left it all. I could not stay another day to laugh, to love, to work or play. Tasks left undone must stay that way. I found that place at the close of day. If my parting has left a void, then fill it with remembered joy, a friendship shared, a laugh, a kiss. Ah, yes, these things I too will miss. Be not burdened with times of sorrow. I wish you the sunshine of tomorrow. My life's been full, I've savored much. Good friends, good times, a loved one's touch. Perhaps my time seems all too brief. Don't lengthen it now with undue grief. Lift up your heart and share with me. God wanted me, he set me free. Thank you.
Thank you. Madison,
if you Madison just sent me a message a little bit ago. She's on the road and apparently her phone died. So she asked Michael if you can read it for her. Michael, if you have two computers on in the same room, that's what's causing this.
Okay.
So turn one of them off and we won't get feedback.
There you go.
Hello, everyone. This is Michael. This is Gloria's oldest son. Thank you for being part of the celebration of Mom's life. I just want to read something that my 21-year-old granddaughter wrote the other day. I just had finished a conversation with Mitchell and Ira, and we were just talking about my mom, and I came home, and I read a post by my granddaughter, Madison, and I'm going to read this to you, and brought me to tears about Mom. A regal matriarch, a true New Yorker, a world traveler, a daughter of Polish immigrants, a single mother to three boys, a top chef in any kitchen, a devout Jewish woman, fashionista, a Costco queen, a storyteller, a superwoman. And this is Madison again. My great-grandmother was someone I wanted to be just like growing up. She was the grandmother who everyone wanted to have. She had quick wit, the sweetest smile, always made sure you were fed and had food to go home with, and always told the truth, even if it was the hard truth. Grammy, thank you for everything. You helped pay for my college. You showed me a couple of tricks in the kitchen. You showed me how to be an amazing wife and amazing grandmother. You lived an amazing life, lived in amazing places, and even more amazing to the whole Summers tribe. My heart is hurting, but I know you are no longer in pain. When you see Poppy, tell him I love him and miss him. I will see you both again someday. I love you, Grams. My mom, Gloria, was an incredible woman, as you heard from Mitchell, the rabbi, and everybody else who is in on this day of celebration. So, Mom, I miss you. I obviously never forget about you, and we all love you. Thank you all.
Eric Summers, would you unmute yourself?
Yeah, I'm here. I'm going to try to follow that. So my grandmother meant more to me than words can express, but I'll do my best right now. She spent 92 years in the world, and even though I bore witness only to little pieces of a third of it, I learned enough from her to her example to prepare me for my own 92 years, should I be lucky enough to ever get there. She was truly remarkable. Her example was something that I write really well. I really suck at saying this stuff. but it's something I care about. By the time I came around, many of the difficult events in her life were behind her. But she gave us all the benefit of her experience and her struggles. She displayed a never-ending streak of love and nurturing toward her family. But there was always this grit and determination behind it. It's something you really only appreciate as you get older. You know, like when somebody's seen some stuff, you know, when somebody is just kind of, her love for all of us is very fierce. The kind of love that someone can only display if they had to fight for it. And I came to learn that although her touch was soft, Grandma was a fighter. I said this in my Facebook post a few days ago, but one of the great quotes is that well-behaved women never make history. And although you won't find the marvelous Mrs. Clark thumbing through your binge list of Netflix programming, I have the feeling if someone was to bear witness to her entire life, beginning to end, and were to produce it, you would watch it. She wasn't the one to let society tell her what she could and could not do. If it was better for her or for her three boys, you weren't going to stop her, especially not because she was a woman or because she was Jewish. Her ferocity and independence were an inspiration for our whole family, and she came by it honest through experience, hard work, sweat, and tears. Our family admired her so much, in fact, that we constantly fought for her affection and favor through an ambiguous system we call notches. If you cleaned up the kitchen for her instead of sitting on your butt rubbing your full belly, boom, you got a notch. If you baked her a strawberry pie, that's at least three notches. You could also lose notches too, like if you ordered more than one alcoholic beverage on her tab, or if you left a piece of her Tupperware on a cooktop while it was still hot and it melted down to nothing. You could lose notches for that. There they go. Somewhere in her brain was a constantly updating leaderboard of the notches, and only you ever had a general idea of where you sat on that standing. Well, as fate would have it, on Thursday, I received an email from an email address that I have no idea where it is. And I usually wouldn't open this stuff because I work as an IT administrator. I usually wouldn't open strange emails, but this one didn't have anything about a prince that just needed me to pay tax on $10 million. This simply said in the title, Notch Leaderboard, final. So I right-clicked on it, and I printed it out. Didn't read it because I didn't want to spoil the surprise. I figured I would read it out while everybody was sitting here. Let's see how we all finish, shall we? All right. In first place, I don't think to anyone's surprise, is my dad. I don't know if I can get it out. His dedication to Grandma these last few years was unwavering and tireless. He managed her affairs. He kept everyone updated. He spent time with her. He sang her songs. He lifted her spirits, even though she couldn't always tell him how much she appreciated it. It takes a lot to do that. Truly, I think I think the family agrees that he has what it takes to sit on top of the final notch standings. We all owe him a deep debt of gratitude. Okay. In second place, was there anything left on the printer?
Well, no, it was just that one.
Oh, well, I guess that didn't print, and I already deleted the email, and I already emptied the trash, so I guess we're not ever going to know who was second place on the Notch leaderboard. It's a shame. I was really rooting for myself, personally. I was one of the only two people who was allowed to drive Grandma around, and Mitchell wasn't one of them, by the way. Poppy was the other one, but, you know, she kind of had to grin her teeth and bear it toward the end there, she was a special lady, and these last few years, it was hard to see, but I'll never forget. I'll never forget what she meant to all of us. So we may not know how we all finished on the Notch leaderboard, but we all know to Grandma, it didn't matter. It was all something to keep us in control. It had no real bearing on how any of us stood. So, but it was just a fun game for us all to play. Let's all see how many notches we can gain or lose. So I love you, Grandma. I'm gonna miss you. Say hi to Poppy for me.
Thank you. Devin?
Yep. Well, first of all, obviously this is hard to be virtual, but just letting my brother know and my dad and obviously all of my immediate family, how much I love them. I always thought that my grandmother was something special. She was generous. She was funny. She was the ultimate ball buster. She was an amazing cook. She was open-minded, honest, and devout to her faith. But as I have been reflecting on so many memories since her passing, a few distinct things, you know, stuck out, confirming what I always already knew. I remember after one visit to see her in San Diego, she made me, my dad, and my brother our own personal chicken parmesan sandwiches for the plane ride. I distinctly remember opening up my sandwich and seeing those around me on the plane look at what I had and just complete envy and thinking to myself, man, my grandma's the best. When my parents divorced, I was pretty young. And I remember that every Christmas for years after, my grandma continued to send my mom a present. And when I asked her about it, she said, she's still the mother of my grandchildren. And I remember thinking, that's pretty cool. Since almost introduction, Grandma always treated Stephen, my husband, like one of her own grandchildren. She was so sweet and inclusive and complimentary of him. He also loved her dearly. She always made sure to remind both of us how lucky we were to have each other because we were both special people. I feel so much love for her and for Stephen and for their own relationship. In the later years, I remember I would often catch my grandma just watching me and smiling. And then she would turn to my dad and say, Hannah Bank. I reminded her a lot of her mother. And that made me feel really good because I know how much she loved my great grandmother, Gams. I have often been told by many people that I'm a lot like Grandma and Gams. And I have always taken that as one of the greatest compliments. When Grandma, or Gloria, as we would say it, with her, I could always be my complete and honest, unfiltered self, which is not always the case with someone that's born in 1928. I hate that this pandemic caused us not to have the traditional goodbye, but I'm so glad I get to spend so much time with her these last couple of years. We know the relationship that we had and know that all needed to be said was said. We both knew how we felt about each other. Grandma, I admire you so much and thank you so much for everything you've done and did for our family. I love you, I miss you, and I was so honored to be your only granddaughter. I will carry your memory with me all the days of my life. To Gloria.
Thank you. Thank you, Devin. Thank you, everyone, for those wonderful tributes. You know, Mitchell Summers and I have been hanging out for 25 years. And that's quite a relationship that the two of us have. It's a quarter of a century. And, you know, in that whole time, when I think about the last two and a half years, in a rabbinical career that spans more than 40 years, it's hard for me to recall somebody that I thought was a more devoted son. I really just wanted to say that, Mitchell, before we continue. It was your schlepping her to Shabbat dinners at our house, your visits to her daily, especially towards the end at Abbotswood. You're singing to her through the window. By the way, if you haven't seen that article in the newspaper, it's great. Mitchell stands outside the window and sings to his mom. The close relationship that you had together, the fact that you travel together, the fact that Mitchell always felt that his mom always had his back. Mitchell helped his mom to move to Oak Island, where she found the life there, including become the queen of Mahjong. Towards the end, he took her to services regularly. I remember she most of the time would sit in the same place. And I wasn't quite aware of how much she was absorbing. But I did notice that a smile and a twinkle in her eye could easily be seen the moment that Mitchell started singing. Again, I don't know what she understood, but with that music and her son singing touched a different part of her brain. And she responded. So I just want to say to you, Mitchell, you are to me the epitome of the fifth commandment, honor your father and your mother, because you, the way in which you honored your mom, it's an inspiration, my friend. But I also know that she cherished all of her family, and especially all three of her sons, and that all three of her sons loved her dearly. I was in Warsaw in the great Jewish cemetery there. There's hardly any Jews left in Warsaw, a few thousand, but the cemetery is gigantic. Maybe a quarter of a million people are there, are buried there. And I was walking through a section and I remember coming across a stone, so a group of stones that were really quite well decorated, and they were all from about the last 25 years of the 19th century. And on one stone for a woman, I saw these words that have stayed with me ever since. I hadn't seen them before, but the words are, Nafla Ateret Roshenu, the crown jewel of our head has fallen. Nafla Ateret Roshenu, the crown jewel of our head has fallen. You know, it's used to describe a woman who lived long and full and a full life, but who was dedicated to her family, and her family was dedicated to her. In essence, Gloria was also an Eshet Chayil, a strong woman of valor. And indeed, if you hear the tributes that were given to her, she was an angel who touched all of us. But she was an angel that touched her family, especially her family, in a proud and in a loving way. You know, those of us who knew her, and again, especially of her family, loved her so much. And they are going to miss her, but they will never, ever forget her. Who she was is truly a challenge to all of us as to whom we should become. Adonai Natan v'Adonai Lekach, Yehi Shem Adonai Mevarach. Thank you, God. You have given and you've taken away, but boy, those times in between were great. Thank you, God, for all of the wonderful times that were shared with Gloria Clark. Nafla Ateret Roshenu, the crown jewel of our head has fallen. Nafla Ateret Roshenu, the crown jewel of our head has fallen. Zichrona Levracha, may her memory be a blessing to us all, now and always. And together let us say, Amen. Each person has a name. We have a name given by God and given by our father and mother. We have a name given by our stature and our smile and given by our attire. We have a name given by the hills and given by the walls. We each have a name given by the stars and given by our friends. We each have a name given by our sins and given by our yearnings. We each have a name given by our enemies and given by our love. We each have a name given by celebrations and given by our work. We each have a name given by the seasons and given by our blindness. We each have a name given by the sea and given by our death. And now in memory of his mother, Mitchell Summers will sing the traditional El Malei Rachamim, the traditional prayer which asks that God will embrace, as it were, with a hug in the shadow of its wings like a bird protecting its young, that God will embrace the holy soul of Gloria Clark. Mitchell.
El Malei Rachamim Shochein Bamromi Am semenu chanechona tachat kanfei hashechina im kadoshim utorim kizoha harakia mazhiri Et nishmat gittel bat David v'chana shel halcha le'olama Baal harachamim yastireha beseter k'nafav Le'olamim Bitzro ha'chayim Et nishmata Adonai hu nachalata V'tanuach b'shalom Al mishkavar v'nomar Amen.
In the rising sun and in its going down, we remember her. In the blowing of the wind and in the chill of winter, we remember her. In the opening of the buds and in the rebirth of spring, we remember her. In the blueness of the sky and in the warmth of summer, we remember her. In the rustling of the leaves and in the beauty of autumn, we remember her. In the beginning of the year and when it ends, we remember her. When we are weary and in need of strength, we remember her. When we are lost and sick at heart, we remember her. When we have joys that we long to share, we will remember her. So long as we live, Gloria too shall live. For Gloria is now a part of us as we remember her. Mitchell, would you lead us in the Kaddish, please?
Yitgadal v'yikadash, Shemei Rabbah, v'yamadi v'rachivote v'yamlich malchute, v'chai echon v'yom echon, uv'chai edachol bet Yisrael, ba'agala uv'izman kariv, v'imru, amen. Yehei Shemei Rabbah mevarach le'olam ul'almei amaya, yitbarach v'yishtabach, v'yitpa'ah v'yitromam v'yitnaseh, V'yitadah, v'yitaleh, v'yitalal, Shmei d'kudasha, berichu. Le'ela min kol b'yachata v'shirata, tushbachata v'nechamata, da'amiram b'alma v'imru, amen. Yehei shlam araba min shemaya, v'chayim aleinu v'al kol Yisrael, v'imru, amen. Ose shalom b'imromav, Hu ya'aseh shalom aleinu ve'al kol Yisrael. V'imru. Amen.
The departed whom we have just remembered, Gloria Clark, has entered into the peace of life eternal. Yet she still lives among us in the hearts of all of us who cherish her memories and by means of all the good deeds that she performed. May the one who causes peace to reign in the highest of heavens, let peace descend on all who mourn and comfort to all who bereave. May God bless us all with health and peace. And together let us say, amen. So my friends, at this particular time, we're going to ask anyone who would like to unmute and say to Mitchell and his brothers any words of comfort and to the rest of the family. And we'll just leave this on for as long as it takes. Mitchell, on behalf of myself and on behalf of Nancy, our deepest condolences on the loss and the same we say to your brothers and to all of your family. May God comfort you among all those who mourn in Zion and Jerusalem.
Thank you, Rabbi Fred. And also wanted to send my love and thanks to you and Andy for that, Rabbi Andy, that beautiful service on Thursday as well. So thank you. Okay, I know you all got big mouths. So if you want to say something, now's the time.
And you can talk.
You're loved, Mitchell.
You're loved, Mitchell.
You got a notch, Mitchell.
You're a special person, Mitchell.
Your mother was incredible. We loved her. We loved having her in our home. She was full of zest and passion, and she was incredible. We love you, Mitchell.
Okay. It was a beautiful service. Thank you for everything and all the pictures. Felt really part of your family and getting to know. I was glad to be here and share all this and send my deepest condolences.
Thank you, Judy.
Mitchell, we love you. Devin and Eric in Baltimore, we wish that we can be with you. Beautiful service. All this love we have for everybody.
Yeah.
Thanks. Thank you. And I want to see you guys at the beach.
Okay. We'll be there tomorrow. Yeah.
Mitchell, even, I mean, I knew your mother and I know a lot of stories from you, but I still loved hearing and I learned a lot and I loved seeing the pictures. Thank you, Devin, for putting that together, and you can see how much your family loved her. I really cherish this. And if anything comes out of COVID, it's the ability to have this kind of witness like that you don't always see.
Thank
you. Is that your dad, the picture now?
No, that's Ed Benson, I think.
Oh.
We love you, Mitchell. I can't wait to get back to normal to see you again.
I know, and I used to love to see you sitting in the front right next to Mom. And I know you miss your boyfriend too, but hug yeah. each other soon.
Beautiful family, beautiful family, beautiful memories.
Thank
God
you.
Bless.
Mitchell, it's Andy. On behalf of our whole family, I just wanted to send our love. This week in the Jewish tradition is dedicated to love. But for you and the family, big hugs from all of us, and thank you for sharing so much of yourself, and especially for sharing the presence of your mom, who I'm so grateful that we saw so often. So just lots of love to you, my friend.
Thank you, Andy.
Mitchell, this was Barbara Beatty from California, your mom's neighbor, and I just want to say thank you so much for being able to join in and the ceremony. And I have to say, in many ways, she seemed like my mom too. So I will miss her. And I'm so glad I now know so much more. And yes, she taught me to play Mahjong and helped me buy my first Mahjong set. So she is the Mahjong queen.
I'm glad you got that right, Barbara.
Yes, Mitchell. This is Jan, another Mahjong player. And somebody gave me a sign that said the Mahjong Maven, and she went, ha, you have to learn to play before you can be a Maven. I said, what do they know?
You don't have to be Jewish to be a Maven.
Mitchell, this is Eddie Benson and family. We love you. We loved you all these years. Be well. Stay healthy.
Eddie, you're the only other Alta Kaka besides me that's in this room. I love seeing you. Thanks for coming.
You're welcome.
Mitchell, it's Marlene.
And crazy socks. Yeah, I'm sorry.
Mitchell, it's Marlene. To Mitchell, Michael, and Ira, I just wanted to let you know how much, and Mitchell knows this already, how much I grew to love your mother. Having just met her when she was actually in the hospital in Greensboro. And continued to visit her and enjoy her sweet personality and the smile, the twinkle in her eyes. And then as Mitchell began bringing her to services, I enjoyed sitting with her or sitting near her and just being with her. She was wonderful. Mitchell, she'll always touch my heart. And I'm so glad I got to know her and learn more about her today, too. It was lovely seeing the pictures that Devin had of her as a young woman, and it was all very lovely. Thank you for sharing that.
And for those of you who don't know, Marlene is the congregational nurse, and she is not only a magnificent nurse, but just a beautiful person. Always greeted Mom so warmly and looked after her when she was at Temple, and we appreciate that, Marlene.
Gloria.
We love you, Mitchell. Everybody love from you, New York. Everybody. I appreciate knowing your mom. I was 8 years old, and until the very, very end, I feel part of your family. I wish everybody peace and love, and we'll miss her. We love you.
Love you. That's the crazy family that sent me that 50-pound box of Katz's Deli that we all devoured the night that Mom passed. It's your fault. I went off my Weight Watcher purple plan, but I love you all very much.
Hi, Mitchell. I'm Gilda. I'm Gilda. I'm the past president of the Jewish Club in Carlsbad. I used to take your mother to meetings and luncheons twice a month, and she enjoyed being with us as well as we enjoyed being with her.
Yeah, I remember she loved your visits when you would come by. She would get such a kick out of it.
Yeah, She loved my dog.
He did. That dog was the only dog that she allowed to jump up on the couch. I remember that.
And she laughed at the house.
Where's Roseman in California?
Okay, I'm going to jump in for a second. This is Jody and Michael. We're in San Diego. My mom, Elaine, and Gloria, probably friends 65 years. And my mom, if she could, would have participated in this, but she's dealing with her own dementia and COVID at the moment. But I've always known Gloria my entire life. I mean, Gloria and Mike have been in my life as far back as I could ever remember. They were there when my kids were born. They were there for everything that's happened in our lives. And when they moved here to San Diego, we adopted them into our family, and they were here for every Jewish holiday and for every memorable time in our lives. My parents would go to the house in White Lake all the time and spend time up there. I mean, I could go on and on. I just want you to know how much it means to me to be able to be here today with you guys. And I loved your mom, loved her.
And listen, Jody, we're so old. I'm much older than you. I remember your dad, may he rest in peace, and your mom. I remember them on Bronx Park East.
Exactly.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I remember it all like it was yesterday. Your mom and my mom, they were good buddies. They hung around a lot.
All the time. And unfortunately, once your mom moved here, the two of them started to, and my mom, actually was when my mom moved here, which was 2016, the two of them were kind of, you know, past their prime. Gilda, I remember you because you used to come and pick my mom up also. And She'll be missed.
Thank you.
So Mitchell, this is Susan. Can you hear me? I know you can't see me.
Yes, everybody. This is Susan, my ex-wife, Devin, and Eric's mom.
It was a very, very beautiful service. I'm very proud and filled with love. And I know that Gloria would be so proud to have been honored so beautifully by all of you. Tommy and I are sorry we're not there with you, but we love you and are very proud to be a part of all of you. We send our love.
Thank you. And mom loved you very much. You know that. She always had a lot of respect for you and admired you so much.
Love you, mom.
Love you, mom.
Love you too. Love you.
So Mitchell, I'll jump in and say, of course, I love you with all of my heart and have been connected to you for 20 years now. And your mom, of course, always had a special place in my heart. And I appreciate and so thankful that I had the chance to see her at Abbotswood and will cherish those memories for a lifetime.
Thank you. And my mom loved Miss Roz. I told my mom would always say to me after she would see it, "Oh my God, she's so gorgeous. She's so wonderful. She's so beautiful." She adored you.
Mitchell?
Yeah.
Mitchell, it's Barry.
Hey Barry, where are you?
I can see you and Devin and everyone else. Yeah. And it was I enjoyed living on 2526 Bronx Park East, and I appreciate being a goyim. Well, I can't remember the word, but I appreciate the love that I was given there by you and your family and Michael, and going to Michael and Joanne's wedding, the first one, I guess. Devin's, oh God, she's so beautiful. I can see you over there with your husband. But anyway, long story short, your mom was very special to me, and I'm not doing too well. But it was a wonderful service. Thank you so much for allowing me to be a part of it. And I will always enjoy being her North Carolina boy.
Thank you, Barry. Barry and I went to college together at UNCG, and we traveled together in the Wing Victory Singers. touring the Catskills. And that summer, Barry lived with us in the Bronx with Mom, and it was a summer we'll never forget.
That's the truth.
Hi, Mitchell. It's Coco Rostoker, your cousin in California.
Hey, Coco.
It's such a beautiful tribute to your mom. She was a fantastic lady.
Very
sorry. This is such a beautiful service, and it's so hard being so far away, but I know my mom and you had a chance to speak on Friday of this week, and I just will never forget all the great times we had with your mom.
Thank you. She loved all of you. I mean, you know, she didn't have a lot of family out in California, so it meant so much to her that there was some family nearby. So thank you. You were all very, very
sweet. Thank you. And all the sunsets we shared with Gloria and Mike, all the fantastic dinners. I mean, just their hospitality, their warmth, their light. They're just so loving.
And she definitely had some sort of family in California. I'm Tristan. I am Jan's granddaughter, and Gloria often would join us for every special occasion that there was. She really was or is part of our family. And I'll let Taylor share about the cucumber salad, but that we love her and we will miss her very much.
Tristan, thank you. I was so happy you were here, but I was trying to figure out who is that woman. So now I'm glad I know who it is. It's wonderful to see you.
You as well.
Anybody else want to throw in their 2 cents?
We just want to say hi and we love you.
Oh, you're not getting away without singing a song. Uh-uh.
For you later, they will, but okay. Shana wanted to say.
We all enjoyed seeing your mom after rehearsals. It was really nice to talk with her, and it was so special to see her, and it always made me happy when I got to talk with her.
And it made us smile when we saw her in the front row on Wizard.
Yes, it was so nice. It felt really good performing for her too.
I love it. So these two girls, watch for them on Broadway when Broadway reopens. But Shana on the left, I have to tell you, the first time she came to audition for Wizard of Oz, how old were you, Shana?
I was 7.
She was 7 years old, and she walked in and she just looked like my family. And I was like, that's what my granddaughter would look like. You are my granddaughter, you know? And so I've always loved seeing her. She just reminds me of Devin and Eric and my family and my mother, and they're both dolls. So thank you guys.
Thank you. We send love.
Thank you.
Mitchell, thank you for sharing her with us over the last few years. I too loved her when we came to the dress rehearsals and would be there during Tech Week. Not always at our best times, but she was a great supportive person to have around. And thank you for opening this up to so many of us to have the opportunity to be here with you today. We love you.
Thank you. Jennifer and I, she is the number one stage manager when I'm doing a show. If she's available, it's her. And she was always so wonderful to my mom. Thank you.
Hey, Mitchell. Beautiful service. Hey, Debbie. Hey, Eric. Love you guys. I didn't get to hang out with Gloria as much as I wanted to, but it was a beautiful service, and I miss you all a whole lot, and I love you guys so much. And if there is anything I can do, please let me know.
Love you, Maddie.
Yeah, Devin, I'll let you respond to that one.
I haven't, yeah, with COVID, I haven't seen Matt in so long. Matt's one of my long time since middle school BFFs, so definitely had his occasional time with Gloria. So thank you for being on this. It means a lot. Love you.
And when we do Annie, I'm going to cast you as Daddy Warbucks.
Yeah, I guess I have to look for it now.
You do.
Hey,
Hey, Mitchell, it's Colucci from California.
Oh, hi.
I just have to tell you, your mom was a pistol. When she was in El Truso, she was always the one that collected the money. And I was always late with my checks. So she would always give me a hard time about it, and I'd have to go over and give it to her the next day, but it gave us a chance to visit. And then after Mike died, I brought her over some of my sauce. And I'm kind of not real pleased at the fact that she never told me she could make chicken parmesan, because I would love her recipe. So I'm sad that she's gone, and I'm sad that I didn't get a chance to have any of her good food.
But I will tell you, all those lovely cards you sent me when she was already in Abbotswood, I always used to bring those cards with me and read them to her. And Colucci is such an unusual name that whenever I would say, Ma, it's from Colucci, she would always have a smile on her face. So she got it.
She brought us a lot of smiles, that's for sure. Thank you for such a beautiful tribute. She would be just so pleased. Thank you.
Well, guys, we're going to shut down shortly, unless there's anybody else who would like to say something.
I would.
Here we go. Who is that?
Hello. I think
Who is it?
Sorry, it was me, but I was speaking at the same time as someone else. I didn't mean to interrupt. It was kind of Jackson. It's Pepper.
Yeah, it's Purple Seagull. I get that. It's Purple Seagull.
Anyway, I love you guys. You know that. And I'm here for you.
Yeah, we're just here to watch Daddy.
We love you guys.
You know my grandma loved those two boys.
I know.
She was going to steal them if she could. Thank you all
for
being
here. You guys already know that I'm here for you, but I just felt like I needed to say something, and Jackson obviously had more to say.
So. He's the leader now. Thank you, Jackson. Thank you, Charlie. Thanks, Pepper.
And we love you, Uncle Michel.
Thank you, honey.
Mitchell, it's Hal.
Hey, Hal. Hal is, we have been very, very, very close friends in the Bronx since I was 16 years old.
I loved Gloria. I've known her as long as I've known you. And she was remarkable. And I want to compliment you on this service. For one thing, living in San Francisco, I'm thrilled that I get to be at her memorial service, something that would have been, especially with COVID, would have not been possible. So with COVID, we do it like this, and it actually works. And also, you know, one of my friends used to want to do, like during the AIDS epidemic, had an idea to do reviews of funerals, because some were better than others. This one would get a really good review. I so much appreciated your honesty in telling her story. And filling in for, I mean, I knew most of those because I've been listening to you for 50 years, but wonderful, you know, really an honor, and made me cry many times. So a blessing on her memory. And thank you, Mitchell.
Thank you, Hal. And by the way, Hal was one of those momses that was up in my house around 6 o'clock waiting for a heaping portion of chicken parmesan and spaghetti.
Oh my God, fabulous.
Okay, well, Eric, Devin, you want, Michael, Sockner, anybody want to say a final anything? Otherwise, I'm going to wrap it up.
No, I mean, as weird as this is, it's great to be, you know, around so many people. So I know everybody always has a lot going on, so we really appreciate you all being here, and I've gotten a lot of love for so many people, you know, so feels good. So thank you. To Gloria.
To Gloria.
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 To Gloria. Okay. I love you.
Bless you all.
Thank you all, and let's be in touch. You know, we've learned a lot of things during this COVID, and one of them is those that really care about you, It's very, very precious. It really is. So again, on behalf of my family, we really appreciated you all making the effort to be here. Mom is smiling, and I know she's with my grandparents and Mike right now, and she is making a huge platter of something. I don't know what it is, but I know they're enjoying it. We love all of you, and hopefully we will hug each other in person very soon.
Okay. Bye, Shalom.
Bye, Mitchell.
Yeah, thank you very much, Mitchell. It was wonderful.
Thanks. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Love you. Hope to see you soon.
Are you okay?
We're done.
No. Mm-hmm.
You want to walk?
Hey, Debbie.